Hello, I'm Professor John Kelly, and this is the Weber Auto YouTube channel. As a member of several Facebook groups for various electric vehicles and plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, I often see the term level 3 charger used when someone is really talking about DC fast charging. Well, I'm here to tell you that there is no such thing as a level 3 charger. Now, there are 4 different charging levels available under the Society of Automotive Engineers Surface Vehicle Standard J1772, but it wasn't always that way. The J1772 standard document started back in 1996, and it has been revised 7 times. The latest version is the 2017 version, and only in the very first 2 versions of that document did it list a Level 3 charging standard as a proposed method of charging, but it was never implemented and has never been used. As a matter of fact, in the 1996 version, it was referring to DC charging. In the 2001 version, it was referring to AC charging. The J1772 standard is only for conductive charge couplings, where you take a charge cord and physically plug it in to your charging port on the vehicle. There is also a J1773 standard that is an older one for the inductive charge couplings. In this video, I will show you the 4 real charging system power levels and types as outlined in the latest version of the J1772 standard from the Society of Automotive Engineers. Okay, to understand the 4 different charging methods and levels, you really need to understand some basic terminology and electrical principles. The first thing to understand is that all electric vehicles and plug-in hybrid electric vehicles use 2 different direct current DC batteries. The first is a low voltage 12-volt battery, just like any other car has. The second is a high voltage 300 to 800 volt battery. The high voltage battery supplies power to the inverter, which drives the electric motors. It also supplies power to the air conditioning compressor and to what is known as a DC to DC converter, which is used to charge the low voltage 12-volt battery. The 12-volt battery supplies power to everything else on the vehicle, like lights, windows, radios, locks, etc. Now, DC batteries, like both of these batteries we just talked about, need to be charged with DC power. As I just mentioned, your 12-volt DC battery is charged with power from the high-voltage DC battery. Your high-voltage DC battery is charged by 1 of 2 methods. When you plug your car into a charger, chances are that charger is fed AC power, alternating current, from the wall. And most chargers supply AC power to the vehicle. Now, as I just said, the batteries need to be charged with DC power, but the chargers are supplying AC power. So somewhere on the vehicle, there is something called an onboard charging module. And I have one right here. This is from a 2016 Chevrolet Volt. And this is a small one. The more power they can handle, the larger they are. On this side of the onboard charging module is an electrical connector that receives AC power directly from your plug-in charge port. So when you plug your vehicle in, you're supplying power to this connector. And then this module bumps the voltage up to a high enough voltage to charge your DC battery and converts that AC power into DC power. And that DC power is available on this electrical connector. So all plug-in hybrid and electric vehicles have an onboard charging module. As I mentioned, this one's pretty small, and this one is only rated at a maximum of 3.6 kilowatts. So as you can see in these photos here, under the back seat of our Tesla Model S is a very large onboard charging module. You can see the onboard charging module under the rear hatch area of our 2018 Chevrolet Volt, and you can see under the hood here of our 2017 Chevrolet Bolt EV, the onboard charging module. Each charging module is rated for a certain maximum amount of power that it can handle. So the onboard charging module in our Chevrolet Volt right here is rated to handle 3.6 kilowatts or 3,600 watts. And that comes from a maximum of a 240 volt source and a 15 amp current rating. So if you multiply 240 volts times 15 amps, you get 3,600 watts or 3.6 kilo, which means 1,000 watts. Now, the onboard charging module of our 2017 Chevrolet Bolt EV back there is rated for almost double of what the Volt could handle, and that was at 7.68 kilowatts or 7,680 watts. And that comes from a maximum input voltage of 240 volts times a maximum current of 32 amps, which equals 7,680 watts. Now, the onboard charging module of our 2018 Tesla Model S is rated at 19.2 kilowatts, and that comes from a maximum voltage of 240 volts times 80 amps. So 240 times 80 is 19,200 or 19.2 kilowatts. Now, as most of you know, there are two different AC charging levels, level 1 and level 2. These are AC charging levels 1 and 2. And AC charging level 1 is based upon a wall voltage of 110 to 120 volts multiplied by whatever current your car can handle. Some cars have the current set as low as 8 amps by default. And if you take 120 volts times 8 amps, you'll get a whopping 960 watts or 0.96 kilowatts as your charging rate. And you'll be there forever trying to get your battery charged on that. Now, on most vehicles, that charging level is adjustable. By default, it's set to the lowest level possible so that when you plug in your charger at your house or apartment or whatever, that you don't pop or blow the circuit breaker. The circuit breaker needs to be rated for at least 125% of the charge rate of the vehicle. Level 2 is based on a higher voltage, 208 to 240 volts. So a level 2 charger requires some specialty wiring in your house or apartment complex or wherever it may be. Now, the second method of charging your high voltage DC battery is with DC current directly. And by using DC current to charge your DC battery, we bypass the onboard charging module and just feed directly to the battery and charge it without wasting any power converting AC to DC on your vehicle. So DC chargers also come in two different power levels. There's DC level 1 charging with a maximum rating of 48 kilowatts, and there's DC level 2 charging with a maximum rating of 400 kilowatts. The majority of DC charging stations are DC level 2 chargers. I have never seen a DC level 1 charger. However, Tesla vehicles with their unique charge port utilize much of the DC level 1 charging design. And what I mean by that is, if you notice on Teslas with their unique charge port, that you can plug in an AC charger or a DC charger and it fits the same connector. There are no pin differences. Everything just plugs in and it's AC or DC. So somewhere on the vehicle, the Tesla has to decide, is the power being supplied AC or DC? And if it's AC, then it has to use its onboard charging module to convert it to DC before charging the battery. And if it's DC, then it can feed it directly to the battery, but all with just one charge port, which is pretty cool. Now, another thing to understand is that the charging station that you plug into your car, which is referred to as the offboard charger, or the cord set, the portable cord that you plug into your car, those do not determine the amount of current that your car needs. There's a computer in your car that signals the offboard charger or your cord set and tells it how much current or how much power to supply to charge the battery on the car. And that amount of current is variable based on the state of charge of the battery and several other factors. So one more time, it's the computer on the car that signals the offboard charger or the charging station how much current to use. So you could go to a charging station like these Electrify America charging stations here locally. And as you can see, there's chargers that are rated as high as 350 kilowatts. There's some that are rated at 150 kilowatts and some rated at 50 kilowatts. If your car can only handle 50 kilowatts or less, you could plug in the 350 kilowatt charger, but it wouldn't charge at 350 kilowatts. It would only charge at the small amount that your car would tell that offboard charger to use. As an example, the Chevrolet Bolt EV back there is rated for a maximum DC level 2 charge of 50 kilowatts. But it can also handle an AC level 1 charge as low as 1.44 kilowatts, pretty small, a level 2 charge as high as 7.68 kilowatts, and a DC level 2 charge as high as 50 kilowatts. It's the same vehicle. You can plug different chargers in and get different charge rates, but once again, the car signals the charger as to how much power to use while charging the vehicle. Now, if we look at this charge receptacle from a 2019 Chevrolet Bolt EV, this is considered a level 2 charge coupler, according to the Society of Automotive Engineers J1772 document. A lot of people call this a CCS for combined charging system connector, but nowhere in the J1772 document does it mention CCS or a combined charge coupler. So that comes from someplace else. This charge receptacle is referred to as a CCS type 1 charge coupler, and there's a type 2 outside the United States and so on. But when you go to a charging station, you will see the letters CCS for combined charging system. And what they're referring to is that this electrical connector, this charge receptacle, is a combination of AC charging on the top, the round part that you can see here with the five pins, and DC charging on the bottom with the two large pins. So let's explore this connector a little bit. As you can see here, there are seven contact terminals labeled 1 through 7. Contacts 1 through 5 are used for AC level 1 charging, AC level 2 charging, and DC level 1 charging. DC level 1 charging actually uses pins or contacts 1 and 2 to supply DC current rather than AC current. Contacts 3 through 7 are for DC level 2 charging. In other words, we don't use contacts 1 and 2 during DC level 2 charging, just contacts 3 through 7. Now let's look at the details for these contacts. Notice contact 1 and contact 2 are both 3.6 millimeter diameter terminals rated for 80 amps at 600 volts maximum. Contact number 1 receives AC power from the L1 wire in your wall during AC level 1 and level 2 charging. It receives DC positive power during DC level 1 charging. Contact number 2 is connected to the neutral line in your wall during charging for AC level 1 charging, and it's connected to the L2 line in your wall during AC level 2 charging, and it's connected to DC negative during DC level 1 charging. So once again, these two terminals, contacts number 1 and 2, can be used for AC or DC charging with 80 amps maximum at 600 volts. Contact number 3 is used for all levels of AC and DC charging. Contact number 4 and contact number 5 are both 1.5 millimeter, 2 amp, 30 volt maximum terminals. Contact number 4 is called Control Pilot, or CP, and it uses a 1 kilohertz or 1000 hertz pulse width modulated signal. The pulse width is a variable signal and is controlled by the vehicle, and it is read by the offboard charging module. And so they can increase or decrease the pulse width to increase or decrease the amount of current being supplied to the vehicle. That same line can also be used to indicate that communication is necessary, and there's actually power line communication available over the conductors on some vehicles. Contact number 5 is used for two things. The first thing is for what is called control status. And what that means is when you plug in your external charger to the vehicle, all of those external chargers have a release button right there that unlocks the connector from the vehicle. Well, when you push in on that release button, there's actually an electrical switch in there that opens, and it signals the charger, the external charger, to shut off. So we know that if you're pushing that button in, that you're either making a connection or disconnecting. And while you're making a connection, it's not powered up anyway. But if this is plugged into your vehicle and charging, and you just walk up to it and hit this button and unplug it, as soon as you hit that button, within so many milliseconds, the charging system is supposed to shut down so that you're unplugging a dead circuit and there's no live power there. So that is the control status right there. Now, the second thing contact number 5 is used for is called proximity pilot. And what that means is when you plug the external charge cord into your vehicle, it has to detect that it's plugged into your vehicle. And it does that quite easily because in the charge connector itself, in between terminals 3 and 5, is a 2700 ohm resistor. And when you plug this in, the charger has its own parallel resistances, and it'll create a certain voltage drop. And so it knows when it's plugged into your vehicle and when it's not plugged in. So once again, contact number 5 does two things. It detects when you've pressed this switch, and it detects when the charge cable is plugged into the vehicle. And there's a Federal Motor Vehicle Safety Standard that says while this is plugged into the vehicle shall not move more than 105 millimeters, I believe. All right, now the last two contacts, contacts 6 and 7, are much larger terminals. They are 8 millimeter diameter terminals. They are rated at 400 amps maximum at 1,000 volts. So 400 amps times 1,000 volts is 400,000 watts or 400 kilowatts. And contact number 6 is used for the positive side of your DC charging. Contact number 7 is used for the negative side of DC charging. Okay, starting with the 1996 version of the SAE J1772 document, as you can see here, it is called a surface vehicle recommended practice. So it's not a standard in 1996. It's a recommended practice, and that's different than an established standard. But starting with the 1996 version here and carrying through, I have four of the seven versions here. I've got the 2001, which is also a recommended practice, and a 2010, which is also a recommended practice. It wasn't until the 2016 and 17 versions of the J1772 document that they actually changed the name to a surface vehicle standard. So it's an established standard. So five of the seven documents that I've referred you to in this video were just preliminary. They were recommended practices, and a lot of that information has changed over the years. By the way, the 1996 version of the J1772 document is 34 pages long, and the 2017 version that you can see here, which is considerably thicker, has 116 pages. So there's a lot of information that's been added to these. Now, in all of these SAE documents for J1772, they refer to something called EVSE, and that stands for Electric Vehicle Supply Equipment. So we've got this term EVSE that's out there and is being used and has got standards set by the J1772 document, but I wasn't sure where that came from. So I did some research and found out that it came from the National Fire Protection Association, NFPA. It's their document number 70 called the National Electric Code, or NEC. And this is the latest NEC code book right here, 2020, and it's really thick. And in this book, there's an article, number 625 right here, and it's titled Electric Vehicle Power Transfer System. And I just want to read the very first paragraph because it defines what EVSE means. It says, this article covers the electrical conductors and equipment connecting an electric vehicle to premises wiring for the purpose of charging, power export, or bidirectional current flow. So the NFPA and the NEC have standards for connecting the offboard charger to the power circuits. And then the Society of Automotive Engineers has the J1772 document that has the standards for connecting the EVSE to your vehicle. And then your vehicle takes it from there. And this is for both AC and DC charging levels. So the J1772 document has a whole bunch of standards as to how the external charger, or the offboard charger, or EVSE, as it's referred to, interfaces with the vehicle. And there's a whole bunch of requirements to make sure that the vehicle is not damaged by the external charger, and that everything will work the way it's supposed to work. And just a word of caution about external chargers. External chargers need to be certified by Underwriters Laboratory or Intertek here in North America to verify that they are actually following the SAE J1772 rules as far as interfacing with the vehicle so that no damage will occur. So if you find a real sweet deal on a real inexpensive external charger, look to see if it has the letters UL for Underwriters Laboratory or the word Intertek listed or certified by it, because they need to be certified in order to obviously protect your vehicle. And if it's not certified, you're taking quite a chance in just assuming that it's going to plug in and work correctly without having any problems. So be aware of that. Well, I know we've covered a lot in this video on the J1772 standard and the four different levels of charging electric vehicles and plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, but we've really just scratched the surface of that document. But it's a copyrighted document, and I can't really show you very much or share very much out of that. For those of you who are interested, I'll put a link in the video description of where to download the photograph that I put together showing you the different terminals of the 7-pin or 7-contact charge receptacle, the CCS charge receptacle. I hope this video has been informative and worth your time. Thank you for watching.